So I just want to say welcome to Impact Thursday night and welcome on YouTube. You have Don and I pairing up tonight. I am here for Ken. Ken is taking a little bit of a Shabbat, so we allow it once a year. And we're not sure he'll do this again after he watches this pre-video. But my name is Julie Winkelman. I'm from the House of Prayer on Friday night. We love the presence of the Lord. This is what we do all night on Friday, just about this and then intercession. So, but tonight, you know, the Lord is ministering to us in such deep ways, right? Amen. And he's giving us his word. And the word of the Lord is where we gain our strength. And Don Curtis is such a seasoned teacher. And he carries the heart of the Lord. He carries the passion of the Father for an hour such as this. And he brings in the prophetic word that we need so that we understand the shifts and the times. And if you understand the prophetic accurately, if you understand the heart of a good shepherd, then you understand that he brings us what we need before we need it. Mm-hmm. So that we're a people made ready. We are a people prepared. So what we desire in the house tonight is that the word of the Lord gets inside of us and that we carry it into the hour that is before us. So I just want to bless you, Don, all your preparation and all that you do to bring us the word of the Lord. And I'll pray for you. And we're going to go straight into the teaching. And then afterwards, we're going to have a ministry time. We will minister to everyone who needs ministry. We're going to bring another psalm back out that is awesome. Takes you right into the heart of the Lord again. And we'll see where the Lord takes us from there. Sound good? Yeah. Sounds like a great Thursday night, right? Yeah. So, Father, we thank you for Don. We thank you that he studies the word of the Lord, and he carries the fear of God upon him, Lord. And he desires to bring your heart forth. And, Father, I thank you that he's laid his life for this. He has laid his life down for this, Lord, that he might bring your word, a word in due season, so that all of us can hear and comprehend and understand. So we bless him tonight. Thank you that your anointing is on him. Thank you that your favor rests upon him, God. Thank you that he is prepared. And I ask, Lord, that you would set the stage for this word tonight. And Father, that you would just make there be an entrance into this word tonight. And that, Father, that there would be such a safeguard in this house, that everything else would go in the name of Jesus. Amen. And that your word would be alive like a fire, Lord. And God, that you would just expect, we have such an expectancy, God. There's such an expectancy in this house. When people come here, they expect something, Lord. So we pray, Father, that you would come. And just make yourself known to all of us in incredible ways, Jesus, because you are an incredible God. We love you so much. Amen.
Amen. Well, I'm honored. Back in the 1960s, when we were all building fallout shelters and things like that, there was a movie that came out that was called Dr. Strangelove, that had a title that says, How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb. Well, tonight, think in terms of Father Goodlove, How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love Judgment. Okay? Now, language is a wonderful thing. Because we can talk about things and we can use words and so forth, and we can communicate valid and true things to each other. But every once in a while, we can take a step back and say, if we were to be a little more precise in our language, there may be some aspects of truth that suddenly come out, suddenly emerge, that help us get a better grasp of things. And not only that, but to communicate things and actually give us options that we otherwise would not have. So tonight I want to talk about discipline, judgment, tribulation, and wrath and what they mean to us. And I'm just going to just here talk about the word judgment, which we tend to use very, very broadly. And I am going to make the case tonight for us to use a more narrow definition of the word judgment, and to incorporate other things to talk about the things that we talk about, and it's going to be key to why it is that I, for one, love judgment. Okay? So let me start here. We have a verse And I want you, as I'm going to read it, and I want you to ask yourself where judgment is in this verse here. I know your deeds and your toil and perseverance, and that you cannot tolerate evil men. And you put to the test those who call themselves apostles, and they are not, and you found them to be false. And you have perseverance and have endured for my name's sake and have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Therefore, remember from where you have fallen and repent and do the deeds you did at first, or else I am coming to you and remove your lampstand out of its place unless you repent. Now, one can use the word judgment and communicate complete truth and make it apply to this entire verse. Or even there's an aspect where you can make it apply to plucking out the lampstand and things like that. But as I have pondered these things, this is where I like to go. This, for me, is judgment. I know your deeds and your toil and perseverance, and that you cannot tolerate evil men, and you put to test those who call themselves apostles and they are not, and you found them to be false, and you have perseverance and have endured for my name's sake, and have not grown weary, but I have this against you, that you have left your first love. See, the judgment is the assessment. I have looked at you. I've seen who you are. I've seen what you are doing good. I'm seeing what you're not doing so good. And my judgment on you is this. It's my assessment. Okay? And this is what I mean by beginning to come narrow, okay, on this. Notice that the judgment here is both positive and negative. I know your deeds. You have endurance. You have perseverance. You are putting the apostles to the test. And that is a positive judgment. Whereas, oh, you've left your first love. That is the negative judgment. Followed by the sentence. Therefore, remember from where you have fallen and repent and do the deeds you did at first, or else I am coming to you and will remove your lampstand out of its place unless you repent. So the sentence is first and foremost a call to repentance. And second of all, it tells us that loving God outweighs what we do. Okay? I mean, if we pursue the love of God, everything else probably will take care of itself. And punishment is prescribed, but only for a failure to repent. And this is my next point. Punishment is not the same as judgment. And I'm going to be making a call and an appeal that we separate the concept of judgment from punishment. And again, I'm going to show you the real benefits of pursuing this. You need to understand that I am not nitpicky about language. Someone comes around and is using judgment in the typical way that we Christians use it, I listen to them and I accept their truth because I know what they're trying to communicate. I'm not nitpicking here. I'm trying to narrow some concept to move us to a better place. But I don't want you to be nitpicky either. You know, I want you to have a more positive aspect of things, but this is not to create division. This is just to, in a sense, expand all of us. Amen. So you need to understand that in this lesson, I'm being critical of nobody in the way they talk, okay? Because language is fluid, and you need to understand what the heart is, what they're communicating, and not specific words that they use. These are the words, happen to be the words that I use. Okay, so let me go with this. All right, before I get to the meat of my things, I want to talk a little bit about finding meaning in tragic events. Or do we need to find punishment in the things that happen? And my favorite topic is Hurricane Katrina, because after Hurricane Katrina hit, you heard various Christians come out and say Hurricane Katrina was some sort of punishment because, well, the United States asked Israel to get rid of some land, or some said New Orleans was a bed of sin and therefore they had to be hit and struck and all of that. But I've raised 5 kids, and let me say something. You never punish a child and leave him or her to figure out what they did wrong. You really need to let them know what the good thing is, what the good way is, and when they don't do the good way, you say you should have done it the good way and you didn't, and therefore this is the consequences. That's how you raise children. If you raise them this way, where you've punished them and they leave them to figure it out, you get rebellious kids. Okay? But was there a purpose to Katrina? And by the end of this, I will clearly, or hopefully clearly, tell you that yes, there was. By the way, this is how Jesus spoke of things like Katrina. Look at this. Now, on the same occasion, there were some present who reported to him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices, and Jesus said to them, "Do you suppose that these Galileans were worse sinners than all other Galileans because this thing befell them? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you will likewise perish." Or, do you suppose that those 18 on whom the Tower of Siloam fell and killed them were worse culprits than all who lived in Jerusalem? I tell you, no, but unless you repent, you will likewise perish. What Jesus is saying here is when some disaster happens, don't look for sin. If you want to look for sin, go to your own heart. You'll find it there, and you need to repent, because unless you repent, one of these days you're going to die and you're going to perish. Okay, but there's a kind of an admonition here that says, don't worry about the stuff that happens in terms of whether it's a punishment or not. Indeed, let me get you to start thinking here. Discipline. Is it primarily about punishment? Judgment. Is it primarily about punishment? Tribulation. Is it primarily about punishment? Wrath. Is it primarily about punishment? And all four of these, if it's not primarily about punishment, well, what is it primarily about? And this is where we're going to find the wisdom, because, see, quite frankly, the way we talk, discipline is about punishment, judgment is about punishment, tribulation is about punishment, and wrath, of course, is about punishment. But because of the confusion, we miss out on what discipline is and what it can do for us, what judgment is and what it can do for us, and tribulation and wrath. So how do discipline, judgment, tribulation, and wrath relate to God's dealing with people, especially we, us Christians? So let's start with discipline. You ready for this? What does discipline directly imply? Peace that comes from righteous behavior. That's what look at these verses here. He disciplines us for our good so that we may share in his holiness. All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful but sorrowful, yet those who have been trained by it, it afterwards yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Okay? Stephanie and I trained our children. We disciplined, but that discipline was training. And it included a whole lot more than punishment. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man or woman of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. Okay? Or, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, that is, equipped for at least some good work, right? For by this time you ought to be teachers, you have need again for someone to teach you the elementary principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is not accustomed to the word of righteousness, for he is an infant, but solid food is for the mature who, because of practice, have their senses trained to discern good and evil. Now, I don't know if you noticed this, but there's two words here that appear in all three of these passages. Trained, righteousness. And practice, and reproof, and correction, and things like that. Do you see how all this relates? And it all relates to peace that comes from righteous behavior. So here's my definition of discipline. Teaching, reproof, correction, and training that leads to righteousness and adequate equipment for good works. It's not just punishment. And the agents of our discipline are the scriptures, right? You've heard the phrase, live and learn. You go to the scriptures, you get to learn and live. Right? Right? You get to learn and live if you go to the scriptures. People and all they say and do to for us. you know, people that come and say, Don, you know, you really did that wrong. That's good, right? Because that's someone coming along and they're being a friend. Or, Don, you did that well. Or the things that people, you know, I've had people who just, they met me and they hated me right off the bat. Okay, how do you deal with that? I mean, that's all part of the way that God is disciplining us. Choices and the profit and loss we realize from them. I make a good choice, I profit from the good choice, that's discipline. I make a bad choice, and I'm in a world of hurt because of the choices I've made. That's not punishment, that's discipline, right? And then life events and what they teach us. These are all the agents of discipline, especially these here. Teaching. The Word of God as it pertains to living in godliness. We study under the direction of the Holy Spirit's revelation of the text. We live and we learn. We learn and we live. Reproof, scriptures and life lessons that reveal the heart and identify new paths on which we walk by the Holy Spirit. You know, we think this is the right way, but then something comes along and that reproof says, no, we really need to head more this way. Correction, scriptures and life lessons that reveal mistakes in our understanding and make our walk more confident. And then finally, training. By faith, we understand that we are God's workmanship and He trains us. So, in the end of the matter, we can embrace discipline, right? I mean, this is good. I mean, Lord, discipline me. Teach me. Correct me. Reprove me. Train me. And I will be a person who works for the kingdom, equipped to be for your kingdom.
Amen.
Okay. Okay. Judgment, right? Anything that can be positively said for judgment? Oh, you bet. What does judgment indirectly apply? Ultimately, peace that follows true justice. Look at, this is the Messianic kingdom. This is when Jesus is sitting on the throne. I am already have determined that I am going to read the case book of the people who come before him. Look at this. And he will judge between the nations and render decisions for many peoples. And they will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up sword against nation, and never again will they learn war. Why? Justice.
Yes.
You have multiple parties coming into Jesus, and they have gripes and they have grievances. And whichever ones of them come out, because it's not a guarantee that everyone who comes in goes in is going to come out. But when they come out, the justice that they have received, the judgment that they will receive, will satisfy them such that they lay down their arms. Okay? Justice is the key to peace. Justice is the key to peace. We are going to there's going to be peace in the Messianic kingdom because we have a king who understands the hearts of men, and he judges the hearts of men, and he judges the nations, and the nations are satisfied with the justice that they have received, and peace reigns on the earth. Okay? So we need to look at judgment from this angle. Judgment implies charges, evidence gathering, determining the truth of the charges, and if guilty, determining the sentence. So Jeremiah 18, 7 and 9, at one moment I might speak, judgment, concerning a nation or concerning a kingdom to uproot, to pull down or destroy it, declare a sentence. Or at another moment I might speak, again, judgment concerning a nation or concerning a kingdom to build up or to plant it, declare a sentence. Judgment is working both ways here. The prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and the others, they were there proclaiming God's assessment of the nation. Where they were right, where they were wrong, and what the consequences were, the sentence, if they did not repent. Okay? Judgment can be a precursor to punishment, wrath, but it is not of itself punishment. So we need to think in terms of judgment as the assessment of the situation. And just from this definition, Notice how this colors this phrase here. Judgment begins in the house of God. Okay? Doesn't that sound a whole lot more encouraging? Okay? Because the judgment that's negative is going to have the effect of helping us change. The judgment that is positive is going to have the effect of telling us that we're doing well. So, definition of judgment, bringing charges against the accused, passing judgment, and proclaiming the sentences needed. But judgment should not be confused with carrying out the sentence. Judgment is a necessary precursor to wrath, but judgment can lead to repentance and change. Remember when David said to David, "You are the man"? You know, right? David had sinned with Bathsheba, got her pregnant. Tried to get the husband to come home and at least have some joining so that the thing could be covered. The husband was too faithful to his troops, so David had the husband killed. And he's all happy and fine with it. And Nathan comes along, gives him a little parable. David judges the parable, and Nathan says, "You are the man." That's judgment. What did David do? He repented. Judgment does not preclude mercy. Jesus, who the woman caught in adultery, where are your accusers? They're gone. No one's there to condemn you. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Jesus, by the way, had said, whoever is without sin, let him cast the first stone. So there's the woman, there's Jesus, the one without sin. The one who the law says the sentence for what she did was stoning. Mercy. Mercy can always be shown. But when he, John the Baptist, saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned judgment you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bear fruit in keeping with repentance." God's judgment is always good and should be valued and embraced. God's judgment is linked to justice, which is linked to peace. And God's judgment can inspire repentance and change. Wrath is warranted when it is the only path to justice. Okay? And judgment does not demand wrath. The guilty can be shown mercy. For example, the woman caught in adultery. And therefore, we can embrace judgment. Father Goodlove, how I learned to stop worrying and love the judgment. All right, tribulation. Okay, can anything be said positive about tribulation? Okay, sure. You got to love this because God is on our side, right? I mean, in all of these things here, these are all the things that we have said, oh my goodness, discipline, I don't want to be disciplined. I don't want judgment. I don't want tribulation. And yet, in every one of these things, God comes along and says, nope, I got plans here for you. So what does tribulation imply directly? Praise, glory, honor, endurance, and joy. So I mean, let's look at these things that describe tribulation. In this you greatly rejoice. Right? Even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus the Messiah. Okay? Or consider it all joy. You notice how different authors tend to arrive at the same conclusion, right? Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect results so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Okay. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the blasphemy by those who say they are Jews and are not, but a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to cast some of you into prison so that you will be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life. Praise, glory, honor, endurance, and joy for us. because of how we handle the tribulation that comes our way. So tribulations, troubles that originate in nature and from the sin in men and women that fall in the righteous and the wicked alike. Okay, and we can list them here: wars, famine, disease, earthquakes, hurricanes, tornadoes, persecution, martyrdom. You know, the list goes on. A bad day of work, right? Bad day at work. By the way, you need to know, this is kind of funny. When I put this together and had scheduled the first presentation of this, right? I had this little thing in the mail, which was a jury summons, right? And the next thing you know, I'm not only there, but I find myself on a trial, deliberating, and so forth like that. And not only that, but while I was on the jury trial, I put out a new release of software at work, and it was one of the worst releases I have put out in a long, long, long time. So all kinds of things were going cratering at work, and I was in a jury room with my phone turned off. Mm-hmm. Not a good week. Mm-hmm. But that's tribulation, right? Minor. But in any case, tribulation reveals the heart. Okay? Tribulation reveals the heart. The one thing about Katrina is that when it hit the United States, it sort of, in a sense, revealed who we were as a nation. It actually, I think, revealed some of the divisions within our nation. It revealed certain aspects of the nation that were not prepared appropriately for certain things. So tribulation can reveal things that are otherwise hidden. Natural consequences can bring about tribulation. So tribulation can be a source or a means of reproof and correction as you learn from mistakes. And tribulation tests faith and causes growth. And as we know, and we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to their purpose. So we can embrace tribulation. Okay. I bet you're wondering if we can embrace wrath.
Yeah.
No.
No.
But nevertheless, wrath, we can embrace the results of wrath. But anyway, tribulation dynamics. I went the wrong way. So let me just review this before we get into wrath. Discipline, peace that comes from righteous behavior. Teaching, reproof, correction, and training that leads to righteousness and adequate equipping for good works, not just punishment. Judgment, ultimately peace that follows true justice, and bringing charges against the accused, passing judgment, or proclaiming the sentence as needed. And then tribulation, the purpose of praise, glory, honor, endurance, and joy. And defined as troubles that originate in nature and from sin and men and women that fall on the righteous and the wicked alike. So let's go to wrath. Wrath is the destruction and or the containment of evil. Very, very specific here. It's different from tribulation. Okay? This, by the way, is why I believe that the church is going to be here during the Great Tribulation. Because it's just tribulation. Now it's tribulation, the likes of which the world has never seen or will never see again, but it's tribulation. Right. It's not wrath.
Right.
And we have a job to do during that Great Tribulation, which is to be a witness and bring in the harvest, the likes of which we have never seen before. And it is going to be to our praise and our glory and our honor and our joy. Okay. And then after the Great Tribulation, what happens? Wrath. The destruction and or containment of evil.
So will we experience wrath?
I'm sorry?
Do you think we'll experience wrath?
We will not experience wrath. Not in the cards for us. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. We're not evil. We're saved.
That's right.
Amen. Right? By the way, note this. You're a Christian. You're justified by faith. That means that the full righteousness that is your future is imparted on your bank account, in your spiritual bank account, right now. Which means that when you see some promise to the righteous, it's your promise. I don't care what you did today. I don't care what sin you committed or how you fell short of the glory of God today. You are justified by your faith in Jesus Christ, and you are righteous as far as the promises are concerned. Okay? All right, but anyway, this is wrath. Out and I saw the wickedness of man was great, and every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Judgment, the assessment of the earth in the days of Noah. Adonai was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. Adonai said, I will blot man whom I have created from the face of the earth. That's the sentence. And then all flesh that moved on the earth perished. That's wrath. Because the men on the earth, their thoughts were only evil all the time. Okay? There was no repentance here. Anyone who wanted to repent could have been on the ark with Noah. Sodom and Gomorrah, Adonai said, the outcry of Sodom and Gomorrah is indeed great, and their sin is exceedingly grave. I will go down now and see judgment. If they have done entirely according to its outcry, which has come to me, and if not, I will know. Then Adonai rained on Sodom and Gomorrah brimstone and fire from Adonai out of heaven, wrath. Now remember that there had been a little exchange between Adonai and Abraham before this event. Right. And, God says, hey, I'm going to go down there and see. And Abraham says, Lord, are you going to destroy the righteous along with the wicked? Far be it from you to do such a thing. You ever talked like that to God? Far be it from you, God? Yeah. Right? Yeah, far be it from you to do such a thing. What if there are 50 righteous people in that city? Are you going to destroy it? Adonai said, no. If I find 50, I'll preserve the city. What about 40? I mean, 10. I mean, are you going to destroy for 10? And pretty soon we're 30 and 20 and 10. And Adonai walks on. Okay. By the way, the righteous in the city, he got out. Lot and his family, the righteous people in that city, got taken out of the city before the wrath came. So wrath, my definition, destruction of the wicked after judgment. Men of women of faith will experience tribulation, but they are exempt, removed from wrath. Wrath destroys, but offers an escape for any who hear. In Noah's flood, Noah's family was on the ark. And while Noah was building the ark, the word was going out that, hey, this guy's building an ark because he thinks wrath is coming. And do you think that anybody would come up to Noah and said, hey, can I get on the ark? I believe, I've repented. You bet. Okay. Sodom and Gomorrah, Lot and his family were removed. Samaria in 722 BC, the refugees could flee from Samaria to Judah. Judah in 586 BC, the refugees to Babylon. Jeremiah 38, 2 is kind of interesting here. When Nebuchadnezzar began to come down against Jerusalem, or actually beforehand, Nebuchadnezzar had come to Judah and carted off 10,000 craftsmen and took them to Babylon. Okay? And Jeremiah sent them a letter. And he said, settle in. Build houses. Seek the welfare of the city where the Lord your God has banished you, for in its welfare is your welfare. Okay? And then Jeremiah in 38:2 is telling the people in Jerusalem, if you stay here, it's plague, it's sword, plague, pestilence, well, the pestilence, famine, and sword. You say in the city it's pestilence, famine, and sword. Or you can go out, hand yourself over to the Chaldeans, and they'll send you to the place I've already prepared for you. Do you see how remarkable that is? That God prepared an entire community for his people in Jerusalem when he was bringing wrath? And Jeremiah's in there, the prophet saying, hey, get out of Dodge, get out of there. Go over there. God's prepared a place for you. And then the wrath came. Jerusalem in 70 AD, the refugees could get out of the city because Jesus in Luke 21 said, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, know that her desolation is near. And he's basically telling his people, his Christians, his Messianic Jews in Jerusalem when Titus brought his armies up to get out of town. So whenever wrath is coming, God is providing the way of escape for his people. We do not have to experience wrath unless we have the privilege that Jeremiah did, which is to be a watchman in the city while the wrath is going on. Okay? Jeremiah is my hero. 40 years of a ministry where no one listened to him. And he stayed faithful to his post. Okay? He's my hero. Men and women can escape the future wrath by justification provided by Jesus' death and resurrection. So believers, wrath, believers, we don't mix. And then this is cool. Wrath always has the face and goal of mercy. Remember in the book of Revelation, all those guys hiding themselves in the caves? What are they saying? Save us from the wrath of him who sits on the throne and the Lamb. Lamb. Lambs are in petting zoos. Why is it the wrath of the Lamb? The Lamb was introduced as the Lion. Why is it not the wrath of the Lion? Why is it the wrath of the Lamb? Because mercy is being extended the whole time. Mercy is being extended because it's the Lamb that is there. So at the last minute, you want mercy, you can reach out and grab it. It is there. This is the other side of the Babylon's invasion of Judah in 586 BC, destroying the city. Wrath can remove the evil that is suppressing the good. In 586, Israel was known for its idolatry, a 1,400-year addiction to idols was entrenched in that culture. 47 years later, when they returned, the Jews were a monotheistic people, and they have been monotheistic to this day. And that wrath and that change are linked together because that wrath removed the evil such that the good could emerge, along with the prophets and things like that that instructed the people and the discipline that came along and the tribulation that came along and all those good things that fashioned a people in 47 years. This is extraordinary. And wrath is the anomaly and last resort. Lamentations 3:18, written by Jeremiah after he lived to the wrath of God poured out in Jerusalem. And Lamentations chapter 3 is his own personal testimony. And he suffered. And he gets down to the point in 3:18, he says, I say my strength has perished, and so has my hope from Adonai. I don't have strength anymore. You know, you need strength to be happy. You need strength to be up. You know, one of the things about depression is a complete lack of emotional strength, and Jeremiah has none. And then he says a quick prayer and says, Lord, remember my wormwood, remember my bitterness. And then suddenly, 18, 19, a little prayer in there, 20, he says, this I recall to mind, therefore I have hope. Okay, he moves from no hope to hope because he remembered something. And what is it that he remembered? Adonai's loving kindnesses indeed never cease, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And Jeremiah is looking at the ground zero of Jerusalem, and the smoke is rising up. He's looking and he says, this is the anomaly. Tomorrow, I could expect loving kindness. Tomorrow, I could expect mercy because his compassions never fail. His loving kindnesses are new every morning, and he is greatly faithful. So let's bring this together. All right. We often speak as if judgment and wrath are different words for the same thing. And when I hear people do that, I listen to the truth they're speaking. I really don't make a big deal out of this, and I'm not asking you to either. I mean, people are speaking truth, and I would rather listen to the truth that they speak than nitpick about words. But at the same time, I, for one, make a separation, and I'm encouraging you to, because it allows us to, it gives us some better tools to live our lives, as well as to address the very real needs in our churches and our nations and each other. But it is better to separate them, because judgment can be positive, negative, and judgment can be for reward and punishment. And judgment reveals truth that we can act on, thus it serves to discipline us. And judgment can sentence some person or group to wrath, and wrath has come from nature and nations. But they're still different. Okay. Discipline, judgment, tribulation, and wrath have degrees. Reading the scriptures can be a judgment on my character and actions and would relate to discipline. But so can reading the scripture indicates God's judgment of our national character and suggest coming wrath. Okay, so both are there, right? A bad day at work can be tribulation, but so can martyrdom. So, I mean, we're... Right. Okay. The thing is that a bad day at work has this much glory. Okay. Martyrdom kind of has right, that much glory. Wrath can take out a false prophet or it can take out a nation. Hananiah is interesting. He was telling the people in Jerusalem, hey, it's going to be all right. Don't worry about it. And Jeremiah comes up to him and says, you're going to be dead in a year. And he was. Okay, so wrath can be on a person or a nation. Tribulation can come from God to reveal the national character. Jonathan Kahn noted how our leaders quoted Isaiah 9 after 9/11, and we can draw judgment inferences from such events. What's going on here is after 9/11, our politicians got up and says, you know, they tore it down, but we will rebuild with cedars. Not knowing that the whole context of this is, I brought you some tribulation, and your response is, you're going to rebuild? And our leaders, instead of seeking repentance, took on the same mantle of pride. And therefore, we can look at that and we can make a judgment on our nation to assess its character. The Iraq War and events like Katrina highlighted our national divide. And right now, we Christians are finding ourselves on the wrong side of culture. We're beginning to suffer for it. Okay? Wrong way. Discipline will equip us for kingdom work, and we are told to expect and endure tribulation, and wrath will be executed to bring about a kingdom of justice. And then let me spend a little bit of time here. Through the Holy Spirit and scriptures, we can discern the charges that God has concerning a person, group, or nation. These are three that, to me, I can read and apply to the United States with a completely clear conscience and reason. Isaiah 3, 1 through 12, the key verse there is 8, for they have rebelled against my glorious presence. I remember, I'm old enough, right? I'm an old guy, right? Sixth grade, going to school, sit down, teacher brings out a Bible and reads it. And we say the Lord's Prayer. And we say the Pledge of Allegiance. And then a Supreme Court case came along, and even though the Supreme Court case could have been applied narrowly, it was applied broadly, and our culture began pushing the discourse of God out of the public square. It rebelled against God's glorious presence. Which means I can take all of 1 through 12 and say, this is the sentence. See, the judgment is, you have rebelled against my presence. The sentence is in 1 through 12. Adonai is about to remove from Jerusalem and Judah both supply and support, the whole supply of bread and the whole supply of water, the commander and the soldiers and the wise men and the diviners and things like that. And I am going to give you absolute fools for government. Any of you think that that's happening these days? Okay. All right. Key verse for you. You guys. Isaiah 3:10, Tell the righteous. Remember, we're righteous. We're justified. Tell the righteous it will go well with them, for they will eat the fruit of their actions. So let's soldier on. Okay? But let's tell this nation that the judgment that it is under, it has rebelled against God's presence, and here's the sentence, if it does not repent. 13 through 15 deals with injustice. Leviticus 18, 19 to 20, family and children destroying sexuality. You want to know what's really wrong with sexual sin? The building block of a nation are strong families. And there is not a single sexual sin that does not put a bullet into the health and integrity of a family. Godly sexuality, strong families, or are an ingredient of strong families. But when sex becomes fun and more important than a whole bunch of other things, the family begins to disintegrate. And at the end of Leviticus 18, it says that nations that commit these abominations, the land will vomit them out. Okay, so there's the sentence. We have the judgment, we have the sentence. Wrath comes later. And Matthew 24 and the growth of deceit and lawlessness that we see in our country. So this is why when we have a narrow view of judgment, we can really talk about judgment. We can talk about the assessment on the United States, and we can lay it on the people of the United States along with a sentence, but we don't have to say it's wrath because God will bring the wrath later if there is no repentance. Okay, so judgment, sentence, wrath. Bottom line though, it's all good. In light of what I've said, which of discipline, judgment, tribulation, or wrath does not play a part in God's redemptive purposes? They're all there. You know, and basically, I don't know about you, but I look at this and I say, God really does love in a profound way. So let me just go take this back to this, and let me close with prayer. Heavenly Father, I give you thanks for this evening and this opportunity to share these things. And Heavenly Father, I ask that everyone here embrace these things in their lives, that we will embrace these things in our lives, that you will, as the good Father, discipline us and equip us for every good work, that through the scriptures and events and things like that, that you will judge our character, that you will judge our meetings, that you will judge our groups, that you will bring a good and proper assessment so that we can know the truth and we can repent where we need to repent and move on with boldness in those things that give you pleasure. We thank you for the tribulation that you are going to bring our way. And we will rejoice when they come. And we just ask that by the power of your Holy Spirit, that tribulation will do all in us that you intend. And Heavenly Father, we pray along with Habakkuk where he says, Lord, I've heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds. Renew them in our day and in our time. In wrath, remember mercy. Amen. So Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this evening and your truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. So.
Thank you, Don. That changes your perspective, doesn't it? This is so cool because the Lord had given me some scriptures, and I'm not reading any of them because we don't need to, but I want to read you the prayer that came out of the scripture to go right along with Don, and then we're going to play a song, and we're going to let the ministry happen in the Lord where he can move freely in here and minister to us the way that he wants to minister to us, and let the things that Don brought go deep inside of us, because God is raising up an army. And he wants his people prepared. He wants us to have wisdom, revelation, and knowledge. He wants us to understand the greatness of the kingdom of God so that we will do this with excellence. But how can you do it with excellence if you don't know? So God sends a people to show us. Well, out of the prayers, skipping the scriptures, the first prayer was that we will be a people uncompromising. That God would let us be a people of great discernment, understanding the times and the seasons, walking in the righteousness of our God. That he would keep us in the fear of the Lord, which will give us wisdom above what we hear and see, able to see with the eyes of God and hear with what the Spirit of the Lord is speaking. Because there is a scripture that talks about seeing with our own eyes. God is like, you need to see with my eyes now, because there's a storm all around us now. There's a whirlwind around us. We can get caught up in the energy of all that. But God says, I have a better way. I have a clear way. I want you to see with my eyes. I want you to hear with my ears. It's a very sobering kind of hour, but it's sobering in an excellent way. And then help us to be in the world, but not of it, to be a people of the kingdom of God, getting our strategies and knowing our position from our Most High God. And ending with 2 Timothy, join me in the suffering like a good soldier of Christ. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in civilian affairs, but rather tries to please his commanding officer. So let's listen to our strategies from heaven, because he knows the way. He makes a way. He's the way maker. And if we stay with him, then we are destined to greatness, as Don has already said. It's just such a different perspective. And the Lord was showing us early this year, it's all a matter of perspective. It's how you see it. It's how you believe it and the way you walk it out. So you get the right perspective. So we're going to bring a song now. It's such a beautiful song. Just let it minister to your heart. Let it go deep, because this is kind of what the Lord is saying to us now. And we'll see where he takes us after this. Amen. And Father, we just thank you for the ministry that comes through your Spirit, God. We just ask for your presence to be so full in this room now, Lord, as you move in and out and you minister to the people in this house, God. Father, would you just release us now to understand your heart, to have your heart, Lord, to carry your heart, Lord. Father, we just praise you and we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, that you go before us, God. And we thank you that your yoke is easy. And we just right now in this room tonight, Lord, we want to release everything to you. Father, I ask that you help all of us to let go of every burden that we are carrying, any undue burden that is around us, God. We just release those things to you. And we ask, God, that you help us to come into a greater level of strength, just a greater level of trust in you, to let go of certain things and just to let go, God, and to trust that you have these things for us, Lord. And Father, that you are so faithful to your word. You are so faithful. You are not a man that you should lie, God, but you are faithful to your word. And there are things, God, that we are believing in. And we thank you that they are yes and amen. So we ask you, Lord, to stir up our faith once again, that we would have faith to believe you for things that have been hidden in our heart for so long. And they've been in that place, Lord. We ask that you bring life back to them again and faith again, Lord. And just trust you, God. You've got this. You've got this, Lord, because you're good and you're faithful and you're kind and you're just and you're merciful and you are for us. And so we just praise you, God. And if the ministry team wants to come forth, OJ, Britt, Nancy, please come forth. But I do want to say this, that as I'm sitting there, last time I was with you guys, I was just like, love you guys over here. And the Lord always brings me back to you because you're so thirsty. I mean, I'm sitting here and I feel your thirst for the Lord. And there's such an honesty about you because you want the sincere things of the Lord. Sincere. I mean, you're not after anything for your own gain. It's like in your spirit, because you've been believing for so long, you want to release something that is of integrity and sincerity on a people. And so I think y'all should do that. I really do, because you're so full. You're full. Your bellies are full. And so I think you really should start releasing that out, because this generation needs what you carry. We need what you have. So I want to thank you for your thirst. I want to thank you that you're honest and you're people of integrity. And it touches my heart. So I want to pray for you again. If y'all don't care, we're going to get a... So Father, I do thank you that there's a people right here that have been so steadfast for you. They are thirsty for you, and they only want the truth. And they absorb you like a sponge. When they come into worship, they're there in a second, God. When your word goes forth around them, they grab it and they hold on to it. And so I thank you for them, God. I thank you that this generation right here before me, Lord, has stayed their course, and they have a mantle, Father, and they have something to give, and they have something of high integrity, and they're watching like a watchman. And their heart is to see this nation rise up and to choose the better thing and to go forth in the things of the Lord. They don't want to see us lose. They want to see us win. And so they're not carrying some of the unnecessary things that we carry. So I just bless them, Lord, in all of their works. I bless their church. I bless them that they keep coming back here, Lord, because they love you. So meet every need that they have, Lord. Just continue to minister to them and to love on them the way that you do, so that they can begin to pour themselves out now. They have a lot to pour out. It needs to happen, Lord. So we bless them to do that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
And I saw you guys. The Lord would say that he is preparing you for such a time as this. I think for so many of you, you have been preparing. And I saw people coming to you looking for not only wisdom, but what I heard was love in your walk and your faithfulness. Because this generation needs, they need an example. And I believe the Father is showing you this, and I even see you guys shaking some of your heads, because that's what this generation's seeking and needing and really looking for. And I hear the Father say, remain faithful in who and what you are. Don't let the persecutions of this world hold you back. And remind me, brother, what's your name?
Carrie.
I really saw tonight that the Lord sees your heart, and he knows your heart, brother. You have a good heart. And the Lord would just say in an encouraging word tonight, if I can pray for you, Lord, just touch Carrie right now, Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, you've shown me his heart. He's been faithful, Father, Lord. And the Lord would say, Carrie, Lord, that he will continue to show you the way and show you the path. For he has seen your faithfulness. He's seen your toil. He's even seen some troubles. And there's times, Carrie, that you may say that some of these troubles are they of God? No, they were not of God. But he was there. And he will see you through. Remain faithful, and he will continue to bring you the desires of your heart and the things that you so seek. I see you down beside of a brook, and the brook is flowing. And even tonight during the message in the word peace, I saw the Lord would say, separate yourself, my son, for beside the brook, the living water that flows is peace. Come find, step away from the world and come seek and find my peace. For I have many answers there that you seek. Look not to your circumstance, or even the things that have happened. But seek me, and I will show you the great revelation that you look for. For many people are watching you, and based on your walk, they will make decisions. So walk with me, my son, so that all my glory may come forth in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And I've got a word for you group of ladies. The love of God is all over y'all. All over each of y'all. And y'all are warriors. I see that there has been so many prayers that have been prayed. And y'all have stood and you've stood and you've stood. And Lord wants you to know he's found you faithful. And he's well pleased. And I hear Father saying, don't give up. Don't shrink back. stand in what he has said for you to do. Much is won on your knees. Much. And you're walking, you're tearing walls down that only happen on your knees. And God has called you for such a time as this. He's planted you right where you are for such a time as this. So know that as you are praying and you are going into the heavenlies, you're bringing down his kingdom perspective. You're bringing his kingdom perspective. And you remember what the Word of God says. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.
Is your name Danny? Is that right? And you guys are brothers? Okay. Yeah. Danny, I saw when you came in tonight, I seemed to see your heart. It's interesting that the song was about the heart. But I see you searching. And I was even given the scripture, Romans 15:13. It says where the joy comes from trusting God. And if I can, I'd like to pray for you. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just lift Danny up in his heart, Lord, for I sense he's searching, Lord. He's searching to and fro. And I pray right now, Father, Lord, that he will separate himself and truly search out the truths. Danny, not what people say, not based on your circumstance, not even what tradition or doctrine has taught you, but the Lord would say, my truth is in my word. And with truth comes joy, peace, love, and tranquility. Seek me those things, my son, so that the fruit of the Spirit will come forth. I pray right now, Lord, in Jesus' name, that the Holy Spirit will come upon him in his quiet time and his prayer life, Lord. In the very quiet hours when he's seeking out for you and searching, Lord, may the Holy Spirit come upon him in a great and mighty way. Saturate him, Father, in your Holy Spirit. Drive that stake in the ground so that there would be no doubt in his heart, in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let me see your hand. In the name of Jesus, I break the power of oppression upon you. I break the authority of the spirit of oppression. We break it in the name of Jesus. The spirit of hopelessness must go in Jesus' name. Depression, we cancel your assignment against this man. We rebuke your authority over his life. We command you to loose him and let him go. Loose him right now. Loose his emotions. Loose his emotions. Loose his heartbreak. Be healed. Be healed. Disappointment. The disappointments in your heart. Today, by the authority of God, I release you from the many disappointments you have, not just with people, but even with God. And it's a spirit that came and it created hopelessness in your heart because of the disappointments, the things that didn't go the way you thought they should have gone in your life. But today, the Spirit of the Lord is cleansing you. And I heard this word, hold it not against their charge. You holding stuff that you got to let go, man. Yeah. And in your heart, you felt justified because you felt you was wrong. But the Lord says, hold it not against their charge. For your true freedom is when you obey me and release them into my hands. And I even heard him say, hold not your disappointments against me, against my charge. Don't charge me for it, says the Lord. And don't even charge yourself.
Amen.
It was tribulations you've been through. But tell him this, I brought him out. I've delivered him with my outstretched arm. It did not take you out. You did not go under. The breaks in the relationships did not destroy you. You thought you would not have made it, but God was with you. And God says, now enter your season of restoration.
Amen.
But it's going to be based on you not holding it against their charge.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, I pray that your mind be unbound. And I feel that there was a great offense that came against you, and it hit you right in the mind. And it's brought such a confusion to you. And God is wanting to go in right now and pull out all that came in through that offense. And I hear that it paralyzed you in so many ways. When it hit, you didn't know which way to turn. You didn't know to go left, or you didn't know what to do. And you were frozen. Well, I come right now, my friend, in Jesus' name. And I stand with you. And I repent for whomever sent that offense against you. And I ask that you forgive me on their behalf, that you may be free. That you may be free, man of God, that you may be free. And Lord, I ask that you clean out from your precious child all the infection, all the tears that this offense has caused. And Almighty God, I break from him the spirit of being paralyzed. You will move, and you will move in the things of God Almighty. For you see, my son, those seeds were planted deep within you. And now is the time that the water can flow, the Holy Spirit, to those very seeds as this spirit of being paralyzed has been broken from you this night. And I speak over you life. I speak over you blessings. I speak over you that you have the mind of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
I just heard the Lord was just giving me really simply, he says that he's going to begin to stir up the gifts of God on the inside of you. That he had a call on your life since childhood. And that call has not been revoked. The gifts and callings are without repentance. And what is past is past. And what lies ahead is your future. And you have an amazing future. And the Lord said, just press in. Just press in and run with me. Nothing's lost. Everything's before you. And you will do the things I put in your heart to do. It's not forgotten. It's not lost. It's waiting for you. So just press in and run. Seek me with your whole heart, and you will find me. Knock, and the door will be open to you. I love you, I am for you, and I have great things in store for you. So don't look back, just look ahead and keep running, and you will see that this is a new day, and you're coming into a new season, and great and mighty things are ahead for you, because I have need for you in my kingdom, and I want to use you because you bring delight to me, and I love you, and I am your father, and you're my son.
Are you raising your hand, OJ? Okay, because I'm looking at OJ. Are you a brother, too, or a friend? Are you a good friend? Because I see the way you're so tender to him. And so I just thought, you know, your heart was so tender to watch over these words and to bear witness with them, and you're very tender to your friend. So I just want to pray for you that the Lord would bless you because your heart is so good and your heart is kind. You're a very kind person. You're a very attentive person. You have mercy. You tend to the needs of others, sometimes to your own detriment, because you're watching over others. And you're good to just let others be blessed. But, yeah, I'm so glad OJ's here, because it's in my heart that you be blessed. You're always pouring out and blessing others, and you don't ever say anything. You don't ever say, I need, but the Lord wants to bless you. So here, OJ, you want the mic or you got it?
Lord, we bless this man. As he have been a blessing to many others. Lord God, we thank you that you are blessing him this day in the name of Jesus. And Father, we thank you that the power of the curses have been broken over his life. And everything that came to hinder his blessings have been removed. Because God, he has found favor with you. You have seen his acts of love. Like you did Cornelius when you told him to send for Peter. Because you saw his heart. And Father, you're reminding me of that story, because you said you have seen this man's heart through the woman of God. And you said, Lord, many times he's overlooked, but today, we start in his household and we declare, you are blessed. We enter into his destiny and his purpose and we say, you are blessed. We enter into his relationship with you and we declare the favor of God upon you. Your feet are blessed. Your hands are blessed. Your mind is blessed. Your destiny is blessed. Your purpose is blessed. My brother, today and from this day forward, walk in the favor of God. Expect God's favor, not just with God, but also with man. For you have entered a new dimension. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed is the meek, for he shall inherit the earth. And God says your heart is pure towards him. He says stop beating up yourself. He's your father. He says tell him this, I'm well pleased. He says, say it again. I am well pleased with you, my son. Embrace me as your father. Receive me as daddy. I'm your Abba. Abba has come to sup with you. And Father, I impart in him right now the gift of vision. From this day forward, he will begin to see in the realms of heaven that he have not seen before. And Father, even as he opened the Bible up and read it, heaven will come alive. For your truth and your revelation, I impart the spirit of wisdom and revelation right now. I impart the spirit of wisdom and revelation. And when you open up God's word, the spirit of God in you will bring forth wisdom and revelation. Wisdom and revelation. Today, the veil has been removed from your mind. And when you open God's word up, he's going to give you wisdom and insight. This is one of the blessings he's giving you today. The spirit of wisdom and revelation. In Jesus' name.
Y'all might want to sit in those seats next week. Don't you just love the prophetic of the Lord? Amen. When he opens up his heart over a people and just gives them his heart?
You ready to keep moving?
Keep moving. Go on.
Greg said, okay, if I pray for you, brother. When you came in tonight, Greg, I saw you. As soon as I saw you, the Lord said, I'm well pleased. And I'm seeing it now, and I saw it then. I saw the military soldier in full fatigues, and he was rising up in the sand, coming up out of the sand. You're being raised up. And the Lord said, I'm well pleased in your actions. And he says, but let not your foot slip. Stay close to me. Be careful of pride. Seek me, for it is my glory. And I will continue to give you the desires of your heart. For there are many who are watching you. For you go to a particular people and a specific call. And the calling is upon you, my son, so walk in it. Continue to go from glory to glory. And that comes by staying focused and keeping your eyes on me, saith the Lord.
Hey, Greg, I heard these words, Amos. I was neither a prophet nor a prophet's son, but the Lord took me. And he said unto you, Greg, go and prophesy unto my people. He says, say this unto him, you are a prophet in training. He says, anoint your ears to hear. Your prophet in training. Your prophet in training. And he says, learn to minister before the Lord. Learn to minister before the Lord. Learn to minister before the Lord. It's not about prophesying as much as it is about being with me. For out of your covenant with me, says God, then I will send you to speak unto my people. Abide, dwell, make me your abode. Learn from me. Be anxious for nothing. Do not look at your age and say, I must go now because my time is short. Peace I speak unto you this day, my brother. Draw close to God because he's drawing close to you. I heard him say, open up the door. Let him come in. Let him prepare the table. Ask the Lord, Lord, where do I need to go and learn? Because he teaches us through people.
I have a word for you. I see you writing in a journal or writing something. You're just writing. And then as you're writing, I can see you move away from your writing into the Lord, and you just kind of go away with him and your thoughts, and you dream the dream with him. And it feels like in my heart he wants to make some of those dreams really come to life for you. Just wants you to ask him. And so it's like whatever you ask him, the answer is already yes. He will do it for you. So just if you would like for us to help you stir anything up, we will do that. Or if you just want to leave that word there, we will. But actually, I would love to pray for you if that's okay. Okay. I'm sorry, what is your name?
Mary.
Father, I just pray for Mary. And I thank you, God, that she is a woman after your heart. And not only that, she's a woman after the dream, the vision. There's a lot inside of her heart, and there's a lot inside of her vision. She has so much vision, Lord. And I pray now, and I thank you that you've already said it's not far off anymore. It's not far off. It is right here. It is right here in her heart, and it is alive. And it is more your heart to meet this need than it is even hers, because you want her to ask, because you want to do this for her. You want to come close as you can. So I praise you, God, that this is a night for a new beginning. And you're moving so close, Lord. And all Mary has to do is ask. And the answer is yes. It is yours for the taking. Whatever you want, it's open. It's open around you. It's open for you. There is an open field before you. You write out what you want. You put in that journal what it is you want. And you watch and see it. The Lord will meet you. He is wanting to meet you. He is here for you, and his heart is for you, and he absolutely adores your vision, and he adores you. In your name, Father, I just thank you so much. Amen.
Right now, we stir up the person of the Holy Spirit that is in you. And I see him rising up. I see him flooding your soul. I see him flowing out of you. I see him flowing in you. That you don't understand, when the woman of God prayed for you, that well burst open tonight. Amen. Listen, that well burst. You're in your now season. Don't say tomorrow, then the harvest. God spoke a word to you tonight, and he says, today, now, is the harvest. And you got to go after it, woman of God. I mean, the prayer has been prayed. The word has been spoken. But the woman of God says something is in your mouth for the asking. Don't put no limitations on God, number one. And don't judge yourself as being unworthy. Like, I don't deserve this from my Father. If he said it tonight and you go and do it, you're going to receive everything he's spoken over your life tonight. Everything is yours tonight that was spoken and prayed. It's done.
And Mary, when OJ was praying over you, I saw the joy of the Lord come over you and you began to dance. So I just thank you that there is such a dance in you. So when you go home, make your living room your prayer closet and dance before the Lord, because then he'll pour out everything in there through your dance, and the joy of the Lord will be yours. And it'll be such a beautiful, beautiful thing. It's very, very beautiful. Amen. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? He loves his people. Well, if the ministry team is good, I have a prayer I'd like to shift us in a little bit. But I just want to say to hold on to your hope, because the Lord is doing great things in us right now. I mean, have you ever felt such the presence of the Lord in a right now time where he's unifying us? And he's bringing us into his heart, and we're not chasing the wind. The wind is around us. He is around us, and we're all being unified in such a beautiful, beautiful way. His heart is tender. He's for us. But I think I would like, if we're going to close out, and I think we are, it feels like we're finished, I would like to close out and just giving you the hope and the encouragement to know that revival is truly in our midst. There's been such a testimony come forth, and it keeps coming forth. And I bear witness in it every day that God's revival is in our midst, that his fire is on the altar, and that he is moving in such a beautiful way. He's starting a fire here and a fire here and a fire here, and we're all coming together. We're sensing it together. We're getting strength. We're getting momentum. Nothing is stopping us. Nothing is shutting us back or shutting us down. It's like he's given us some kind of unction that is from heaven, and we're just going forward. And so I just want to just thank him for that in closing. Father, I just thank you that you are for your people, and you have sent your word out ahead of us, God. And Lord, the anointing of the Lord that is on us is for your pleasure. It is for your glory, because Father God, we are giving a witness of your name in this hour, Lord. We are going out for your name's sake, Lord. We are making your name great in the nations. We are joining together to have one voice that says, Abba, Father, that cries out Jesus in this nation, so that many can come into salvation. Many can be freed, Lord, and come into deliverance and come into the power of God and know who they are. Know that you died for them. And there is resurrection power to be had in this hour, Lord God, that we rise up out of the ashes, Lord, and the dry bones come to life. This is our season, Lord. Revival is in our midst. And we're so hungry for you, God. And we just ask for more. Just more, Lord. More, Lord. Just pour yourself out, God. Let there be a fire that cannot be quenched. Lord, we pray for oil. Fill up our oil lamps, Lord, to where we're overflowing in the highways and the byways of our lives. Wherever we go, we touch people for your name, Lord. That everybody that is around us, we're in this place for a reason, God. We're going to minister day and night, 24/7, because we are the light of the world, and we're breaking in through a gross darkness. And we're bringing the name of Jesus. And so we thank you, Lord, that this anointing is on us, because we are the bride. We are the bride, and we are the head and not the tail. And Lord Jesus, we thank you that your word is alive inside of us. So let us be a people that live. We want to live. We want to live. This is a time to live and be full. So thank you for filling us up, Lord. And thank you for this night, God. Thank you for all that you did and all that you're doing. And all that you want to do. We give you all the glory, Lord. In your mighty name we pray, Abba. Amen. So goodbye to everyone on YouTube. Have a great night.